Of all Walt Disney's animated classics, the heartfelt story and natural wonders of Bambi seem to touch more people more deeply than any of the fantasy worlds created in his fairy tales. Now, through music, footage, and artwork never before seen by the public, we will celebrate the making of this Disney masterpiece.
What you gonna call him?
Well, I think I'll call him Bambi.
Bambi. Yep, I guess I'll do all right.
Walt Disney started planning Bambi in 1936 while still in production on his first full-length animated feature, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. In the following rare excerpt from the original Disneyland television series, Walt explains how his artists finally achieved Bambi's breathtaking realism.
From Snow White, we gained more experience and the courage to take another big step. We'd make a cartoon feature starring only animals. Now, we'd long been interested in the works of Felix Salten, and one of these we felt was ideal. It was Bambi, the story of a deer. We knew that to retain the charm of these creatures, our animated drawings must fully capture the natural movements and attitudes of living animals.
At first, animals were brought into studio art classes for close-up study by the Disney artists.
Drawing on any animal that you have to make appear to be real. You're just making it believable that the audience accepts it as real. And you have to draw them accurately.
A pair of baby deer, appropriately named Bambi and Feline, were imported from Maine and happily housed behind the studio where the animators could have access to real moving inspiration.
The trouble with pets is they act like pets, and that wasn't what we were looking for. So we tried a new approach. We would study motion pictures of wild animals living in their natural state. And in time, we added many reels of wildlife scenes to our Bambi research. Now we could see how a fawn would react when out exploring on his own. At last, our artists had the authentic action and inspiration they'd been looking for.
If you look at the deer in Snow White, you'll find that they were almost sacks of wheat. I'm not going to be able to draw them very well, but this basically was what we had. And we had not reached the point where we were concerned about the anatomy that the deer has. But these were the structural things that we worked over and over, and he just drilled us and drilled us and drilled us to understand what the anatomy, what the bone structure of these little guys were.
To create a realistic look, nature photographers documented the hidden textures of the forest environment. Disney artists created hundreds of paintings and drawings that captured the many moods required to bring the forest to life. What makes many of these drawings even more remarkable is that despite their incredible detail, they're actually extremely small. Pastels and watercolors captured the seasonal colors and emotions of life in the forest.
I think Walt realized fairly early that he would not be able to do it with a lot of dialogue, a regular storytelling type of thing. And he had to rely on art, beautiful artwork, and the music to create a mood, to create a feeling. He was able, through several artists, mainly Tai Wong, a Chinese artist who just did beautiful work of the forest.
If you ever wondered how the artists perfected such realistic details as a single drop of rain, here's the secret. Animators studied slow motion photography of drops of milk that revealed the elaborate splash patterns that usually disappear in the blink of an eye. Strange shapes began appearing on the animator's drawing boards. Drawing by drawing, drop by drop, a rainstorm was created.
It's a little April shower, beating the tune as you follow all around.
While the images for this raindrop sequence always remained the same, an early concept considered a different song to be sung from the point of view of the falling raindrops. Even here, the technique of using vocals as a scoring tool is evident. Presented here for the first time is the original test demo of the rain song from June of 1938, illustrated with concept and storyboard art. Once the animators were comfortable with drawing real animals, they had to adapt them into characters that could supply the range of expression and emotion needed to tell the story.
And you look at a deer, and boy, there are a lot of bumps and bones and muscles on there. And then you have to try to get expressions and attitudes. And I think Mark Davis was the guy who really opened up the door for us, showing us how you could get animatable expressions, human attitudes on a deer. Fantastic job. Without him, I don't think we ever would have made it.
One of the reasons that I came to the studio was that I was more or less expert in the drawing of animals. I took a huge book on baby behavior, and we'd go through, and every interesting child's face, I would interpret it into the mask of this young deer. And I think this was a turning point for the creation of the character.
A cute baby rabbit character was developed to give the story much-needed comedy relief.
I'm thumping. That's why they call me Thumper.
I guess I had more fun with Thumper, and I liked his personality. He was so kind of precocious, and always telling Bambi what to do. Continually getting himself in trouble by saying the first thing that popped into his head.
Just eat the blossoms. That's the good stuff.
Thumper?
So I liked the scene because that offered some good acting, and it offered a change of attitude, because when his mother says, Thumper, what did your father tell you? Then he goes down, you know, about what, you know, and then, oh, that one, and then...
Eating greens is a special treat. It makes long ears and great big feet. But it sure is awful stuff to eat. I made that last part up myself.
I like Thumper just as much today as I did then. It's really kind of fun having that as a part of my life. As a four-year-old, I didn't read the copy. The way the recording was done was in a sound studio with a director, reading the lines with the inflection and the enthusiasm that they wanted, and then I did it back to them.
He doesn't walk very good, does he?
It was done numerous times until they got it just the way they wanted.
What did your father tell you this morning?
If you can't say something nice, don't say nothing at all.
Here, in rare newsreel footage, we see a group of studio visitors watch as Frank Thomas animates a sequence with Thumper. Characters were animated using pencil drawings on paper that were then photographed to test the flow of movement and expression. Disney Studios' ink and paint department created all their own paints. For Bambi, nearly 250,000 cells were drawn and painted. When you combine that figure with the animation drawings, concept art, layouts, character designs, and backgrounds, over 1 million drawings went into making a little fawn come to life. Pretty amazing, isn't it, Bambi? To heighten the realism of Bambi, the multiplane camera was used extensively. By painting different layers of a scene on separate sheets of glass and moving them independently as they're photographed one frame at a time, flat art could create the illusion of depth. This opening sequence is an excellent example of the magic of the multiplane camera. When Bambi was first released in 1942, it was an immediate triumph and was recognized as one of animation's all-time greatest artistic achievements. Even now, over half a century later, Bambi continues to delight audiences. Perhaps because of its stark realism, it also lives on as one of childhood's most vividly memorable family classics.
We think that Bambi was Walt's favorite picture. All our features were different, but this one was the most different. The death of the mother is the one picture where somebody is really killed, and there's no fairy dust or lover's kiss to bring her back to life. She's dead. And I think that's the big thing that made this so different.
Bambi stands out as one of the first environmentally conscious films ever made. It shows that without responsible thinking, man can easily become the enemy of nature.
I'm a lover of nature. In fact, I respect nature very much. I feel that through watching, observing the habits of the creatures of nature, man could learn a lot.
The careless hunter's campfire almost destroys everything we've come to care about and serves as a valuable lesson for everyone to respect all of nature's creatures and habitats. Despite the inherent traumas and heartbreaks of the struggle for survival in the wild, Bambi and his friends give us a life-affirming example of the resilience of the spirit.
I think of the happiness in it and the realism of the happiness. The happiness was not forced, they were not gagged. But they were things that you might find in your own family, in your neighbor's children, in your own children. And it just lived in your heart for years afterwards.